Okay, can I ask Tony Orgy, Chair of the 813-07 Local Liaison Forum, to speak on the issue? And then, obviously, I'll open up to wider discussion. Councillor Orgy, welcome.
Thank you very much.
I'm not aware of any time limit. If you start going on for days, I'll probably stop you.
I shall try and be concise, but I do want to make a few points.
Look forward to it.
If I can start off by saying the Local Liaison Forum meeting was scheduled to be between publication of the report and today's meeting and next week's meeting of the Executive Board. It was then unfortunate that the report was only finalised at 4 o'clock on the afternoon of the day of meeting of the Local Liaison Forum, and therefore people attended the meeting had very little opportunity before the meeting to actually get involved in the report itself. We did have a clear presentation at the Local Liaison Forum that went through the various sections that you indicated there, but I do feel that looking towards the future, it is unacceptable for papers to be available less than 3 hours before a meeting starts, and we want to make sure that that doesn't happen again. This was the first meeting of the Local Liaison Forum, and therefore some of the points made, in a sense, went back to issues that had already been discussed, such as rail, heavy rail, or light rail. But what I want to do is really to take the recommendations that are going to the Executive Board and simply work through them geographically from the Haverhill end into Cambridge.
Would it help if we had the appropriate slide up?
Yeah, that would be very useful.
If you could, please, thank you.
It's really paragraph 4B, little dotted one. Okay, right. So the first one is about road safety enhancement between Linton and Horsey. General feeling was, in a sense, yes, you couldn't really oppose this, that's fine, but would like to have seen more details, you could say. There wasn't much that was actually said about that, and we've actually heard a little bit more today. Two, improvements to signalised junctions and westbound bus lanes in Linton. Well, there was considerable discussion about that. First of all, there's traffic congestion in Linton both ways, in the morning heading into Cambridge and in the evening heading out of Cambridge in the Haverhill direction. And it was pointed out that there was nothing about improving bus journeys going eastwards as opposed to westwards. So that was the first point. The second point was about the two signalised junctions. There was considerable discussion about the signalised junction at Linton Village College. Two points about that, one of which is that some people spoke very much in favour of having a roundabout there as opposed to improving the signalised junction. And the other point was made about the signalisation at the junction itself. It was stated that MOVA could be introduced, which would improve situation at the junction by between 10 to 13%. And the point was made, I thought, very sensibly, well, this is, in terms of the whole scheme that we're talking about, this is very low cost, and why can't we implement that or try it for a trial period anyway? Because one of the problems, it seems, is that we have small amounts of money for things like local highways improvement schemes, and we have multi-million pound schemes on the other hand, and we can't sometimes seem to find those intermediate sums of money that could make a significant difference. So I thought that that would be worth implementing, at least on a trial basis. The third point down here is about measures to improve bus journey times through Linton High Street. It's difficult to find the right words to describe what was said about this, but incredulity and a lack of consultation with people in Linton Parish Council, District Councils, seem to know nothing about this at all, but were very, very critical of what was suggested there. New and improved cycleway between Baleham and Great Abington / Granter Park. This was the one issue where the broad principle was very, very much accepted. But it was all about the detail. First of all, the cycleway bridge over the A11 has steps as opposed to a ramp access. So it's not user-friendly at all. So the idea of having ramp access was very, very much appreciated. But it went a bit beyond that, because the bridge itself, the safety railings at side aren't very high, and it was felt that there could be an improvement to the bridge itself, as well as the access up to the bridge. And certainly improvements of cycleway on the far side, the Cambridge side going towards Baverham, and on the side coming south, it was felt those the cycleways there was non-existent on the south, you just cycle across a field. Those really were very badly needed improvements. So there was widespread support for the general principle, and the issue was really, let's make sure we get this right. New park and ride site near the A11. Well, there were six suggested sites, or indicative sites, on the diagrams that we were shown. I think people thought there were problems with all of them, really. On one side, on the southeastern side, any traffic there coming off the A11 would then have to cross traffic on the 1307 to access the sites. But of course, a lot of the 1307 traffic is going up to four one-ways and then goes north or south on the motorway and wouldn't be using the park and ride site there. And the other site, very close to Baverham Village, down a relatively small road, and it dips down very much there, so when you come up that road towards the 1307, you've actually got very severe visibility problems to your right. There are also felt to be issues there. So there are real concerns about these indicative suggestions for sites there, and also the wider view that is this the right place for an outer ring park and ride site anyway, and some people would very much support a park and ride site to the east of Linton, maybe even as far as Haverhill in some people's views. The new westbound bus lane between the new park and ride site and Hinton Way. Well, I commuted by bus for 18 years on this route between Little Abington and Cambridge, and the one place that you never got held up was really between Four Wentways and the top of the Gogs. Yes, you get held up as you go down the Gogs, but that other stretch of road is one of the fastest bits of the road where you can almost guarantee you're never going to be held up at all. And obviously, going down the Gogs is enough matter, and buses can get caught in the congestion there before they can get to the roundabout and then go around the Wards Causeway link in the rush hour. So there are issues there. And as you go over the Gogs, of course, there's quite a dangerous junction with a number of accidents in terms of the road, Haverhill Road going down to Stapleford and across the farm shop on the other side. There were concerns about what was suggested more in terms of the detail. I think people accepted the need for improved safety there, but there were issues about, was the sort of thing that we saw being proposed really going to be sufficiently safe enough at that point and to allow for all people crossing? And the final point, a new segregated bus route from the Baverham Park and Ride site to the Cambridge Biomedical Campus. The local liaison forum found it difficult to engage with this because there was the suggestion, is it off-road or on-road? And therefore, people's views might very much have been affected by which of those two was suggested. And we've heard from Jim that there's actually an alternative round Wards Causeway anyway that's already there and is typically used by buses on this route going into Cambridge in the peak time. But when you look at the on-road route, it seems that as you go into the built-up area of Cambridge, there's hardly room to squeeze a bus route in there with maybe cycling facilities as well in the space that's available. So there were questions about, are some of these proposals feasible? And there's also the more generic question, that is that some of these proposals might require land to be purchased. That's not within, say, the highway verges and so on. And the question was asked, have all the potential landowners actually been consulted about these outline proposals that we had at the minute? And the answer that we were given was that some had been, but not everybody. And finally, coming up to the Addenbrookes roundabout, there was mention of work between councils and officers and residents about improvements to the Addenbrookes roundabout and also a potential new access into the Addenbrookes bus station, and had that been factored in, and were we actually working together? Was there actually joined up thinking on some of these matters? So in a sense, those are the type of comments that were made. We had a very full discussion at the end of it. In order to try and make sense of what everyone was saying, I did take a vote. First of all, of the local liaison forum members themselves, and then I thought, well, anybody else who's turned up at the meeting deserves to have their voice heard as well. So I also took a vote of those as well. And in both cases, the clear view was that really there should be a pause in the whole process while further work was carried out on this corridor before issues were put forward for determination. To in a sense build on the point that Jim made, we're talking about the biomedical campus and Grantham Park and Bayview. But there's another significant player in all this, and that's the Wellcome Genome Campus on the A1301, which is very close by. And yet, in a sense, that doesn't figure in this at all. And yet, those three southern campuses, really, there does need to be interconnectivity and a relationship between them all, which is simply missing from this. And that's why there was this feeling that there ought to be a pause. Well, in a sense, the wider picture was looked at. Because, okay, there are many issues on the 1307, but in a sense, we do need to take that wider picture into account. So I think I've tried to cover... And there was also a question, are we talking sufficiently to local councils as well? There was one person from Braintree District, which is maybe a bit surprising, but Braintree actually comes up as far as Stirman, which is just beyond Haverhill, and the impact from developments down there. And we shouldn't also forget that, in my experience, a lot of people in work, particularly younger people on lower salaries, can't afford to live close to Kent, and so they do live some very considerable way out, which may even be beyond Haverhill. It's not only just as far as Haverhill where they come from, but it's also beyond them. In a sense, are we talking to a wide enough selection of local councils as well? How integrated are we working with them? I know we've talked about it for many years, but are we really doing that in any meaningful way? So, as I say, there was a very, very broad consensus, something like 3-1 in favour of suggesting that we pause this. So I took a vote for my benefit to make sure that I could reflect the feelings of the meeting overall. And I'm trying to give you a flavour of that.
Okay, and could you, just for clarity, sort of roughly how many people were at the LLF and what sort of cross section? Were they all from one place, or what's the action?
Well, I did an approximate count. There were about 17 or 18 people on the forum. They ranged from people at Haverhill, villages to the east of Linton, right down to representatives from Queen Edith's. So.
And as well as the public.
Yeah, and there was about a certain number of the public, so it's about 30 to 35 people altogether.
Okay, thank you very much. So the recommendation from the LLF in the end was...
What I'm saying is the sense of the meeting was that there should be a pause while we have do further work and make sure that's more joined up than in the way that I've tried to indicate.
Thank you. The first thing I'd like to ask officers is why the report got to the LLF at 4 o'clock in the afternoon of the LLF, though?
I was in contact with officers, and they did say when they were published, and officers did bring about 20 copies to the meeting itself. But
that was helpful.
They did their best under the circumstances, but it was far too late.
So, officers, why was the report got to the LLF far too late, and are there measures in place to stop this happening again? Please, who done?
Kevin, I'll take that. I think first thing to do is to apologise, and I'm sure we did apologise at the time when we arrived at the LLF's sprint offices, because clearly it wasn't our desire to get it that late. The simple answer to the question is that it just wasn't ready, so it should have gone out, I think, on Friday afternoon. It simply, from an audit review, myself and others reviewing it, it wasn't quite ready as a report. And so, we had a choice of either putting out, and I made that call, and a choice of putting out a report that I wasn't comfortable with, because it needed some further work, or actually putting it out later in its correct form. So the decision was taken to do the latter, which is unfortunate. I apologise for that, but I would prefer to put something out that we can say it's actually the correct report. That's the honest answer, Chairman.
Okay, thank you for that. So I'll open this up to wider questions from the Assembly. Councillor Cuffley, would you like to start us off?
Yeah, a lot of what I was going to say has already been addressed by Councillor Orgy. But there are the other big concerns were, and I noticed that on today's presentation there have been a few tweaks, but definitely won't say that to the LLF, which is a bit worrying, because one of the big concerns at the LLF was that there's a distinctive lack of a holistic overview of it, and that fact that Bayes and Edmonds haven't been consulted, Newmarket haven't been consulted, Royston hadn't been consulted. I think the list could just go on and on and on about the lack of consultation. Yet today we're hearing that you have been talking. So there's a conflict there. The fact that a bus lane can take you to work, dump you there, leave you there, not bring you home, really is not the best idea in the world. Regarding the roundabout, the reason we was given for the roundabout was it would take too long to do. So you're looking at a bigger picture here, a 30 to 50 year plan, and because the roundabout's going to take 6 to 9 months to put in, it wasn't classed as an idea. Can't see the logic in that one as well. The safety aspects were brought up by the LLF as well. So, in general, there's another thing as well, is the Genome Centre was not included in this. And I was under the understanding that one of the big concerns with the 1307 was Sawston, and that it would incorporate Sawston. Because Sawston is a massive growing area, and a rapidly growing area, and it has a lot of the science parks coming in its way. And yet, Sawston had not been considered as any means of connection with this at all, which is very worrying. We've gone down the 1301 prospect, but there's a traffic coming from the A11 and the 505, all meeting and stopping. So again, when you're looking at your strategic places for the P&R, it was a bit concerning that, as far as I'm aware, on the original consultation, Bayham Institute or Bayham Village wasn't on that consultation. It was just mainly around the full Wentways area. So there's a particular member of Bayham that was actually quite shocked that it was his farm that was an idea. And he stood there and said, well, I've just turned up to this meeting. I wasn't actually coming. And his comment was, I am now glad I did, because that's my land, and I have not heard of any of this at all. So he was slightly upset. So, if all the options are, and there's another part about joining up Leeton High Street with the 1307 and the bus route through it. And Leeton High Street, if anyone knows it at all well, is extremely narrow. The result of getting a better bus route was to make it even more narrower. Again, a bit concerning that you're going to make a very narrow, dangerous road narrower, so now no traffic can get through. So I think that all in all, as was said, the general feeling of it was that this project should actually, we actually wanted it, we wanted to put this out in the open, we wanted this pulp, because we just thought there was so much critical detail that wasn't there, and that no one can actually make any form of reasonable judgment to take this forward or anything. So we do seriously need to have a big review on it. We need to have, there are a load of questions that need to be answered. Thank you.
Is there any that you want answered right now?
If you've got the time, if we've got the time.
Yes.
Like, what would you consider regarding the roundabout situation? The narrowing
it's outside Linton Village
College. Outside Linton Village College. The narrowing of the road down the High Street. A one-way, a bus route going one way or one way only. Why Sawston wasn't included? Why the Genoa campus wasn't included? Should we just leave it at that for starters?
Who'd like to answer that?
Can I just make a general point and then I'll pick up the bus point and then colleague Jeremy Asher can answer, I think, more detailed points because they've been the consultants. I think just the general point to make is that these are not detailed proposals at this stage. So it's array what you talk about, which is further work.
There will be details given to us, so
but there will be the point about these broad recommendations is that we have narrowed down from what in the presentation I referred to as ideas to concepts now. But actually, before the next consultation, there will have to be a significant amount of additional work. So just to be clear, what we have here is not the subject in itself of what will be the next consultation. There will be a lot of technical work, there will be further modelling, there will be environmental and other works and all those sorts of things.
Can I just stop you there? Because at the LLF, there were specific diagrams of where the westbound bus route would go, specific diagrams of the six park and rides with the two preferred park and ride sites, specific details of bus priority. But you're saying that these aren't details and they're only concepts. Is that correct?
Chairman, what I'm saying is that we've narrowed down from ideas to something that is much more specific, but there is a lot more technical work that needs to be done. So, for example, you refer to park and rides, there are a number of potential park and ride sites and we need to narrow down to a single park and ride site. And I understand the points that Councillor Cuffley has made around some of the details in, for example, Linton. So the consultation will be will follow further technical work that will refine those details. Now, there is a lot more work to be undertaken. So I'm not saying that necessarily addresses the points that have been flagged.
Well, can you explain to me what roundabout is completely rubbish in that conversation? You're saying that, and yet at that meeting, the roundabout is going to be completely rubbish.
I think there's a bigger picture here. Is the question that needs to be asked of officers is why is this presentation so much different to what happened at the LLF?
Yeah, that's a big question.
Well, Chairman, I'll answer that point. So I've given this presentation as a sort of high-level summary of where we are now. I wasn't at the LLF, but my understanding is, of course, the LLF, discussed, because of the nature of the discussions, in a lot more detail, the proposals that are coming out. And the whole point about the LLF is that it is a consultative forum to actually inform the process, and there will be ongoing discussion. So today, the brief is, to keep it relatively short, to stick to about 10 minutes to, just inform the Assembly, because there is a report that's available, the background report that's in the background documents, with all of those details in. So what I've done is given a high-level summary in what turned out to be more than 10 minutes of the set of proposals.
Okay. I'm going to challenge you.
Go into the details.
Because we go to an LLF to seek what the community think about your proposals. And then, because an NLF doesn't like your proposals, you change the presentation so that we don't know what the NLF's talking about. And that, to me, is a problem.
Well, Chairman, I think that is just not true. So, the points that have been discussed...
Okay, Councillor Orgy, is this the same presentation?
I think the one up there is, basically we went through the various sections and they've been drawn out in more detail here, and that was gone through verbally if I remember rightly, and then we did have these more detailed indications that you've indicated said. So there was a for example a shot of the roundabout at some potential roundabout at Linton, the Village College
and the six park and ride sites
and the six park and ride
and the bus priority. So this isn't the same presentation, but we're asking for input, but we haven't got the same presentation.
Chairman, my point is that The elements of the package are exactly the same elements as were discussed, so I've broken it down into the six sections, which are the same six sections that were discussed at the LLF. The recommendations before the Assembly today are the same recommendations that were discussed at the LLF. And so, and the technical report on which this presentation has been based is exactly the same report that's been discussed at the LLF. So clearly, if you like, a more consultative forum with more time will have discussed things in different levels of detail. What I'm trying to do here today is to say, without dipping into all that detail, the six sections are as Hilden proposed here and as recommended in the board's report.
Thank you. I obviously have lots of questions, but I'm not going to hold the floor. So has anyone else got any questions? Go, Dusty.
There seems to be great potential for drama around this one, which I don't quite understand. However, objectively reading the paper, looking at the presentation, understanding the zone, this seems to me to be a real proposal with great potential for actually improving access for many people between their homes and the destination. So I'm very interested in it progressing rapidly rather than being slowed down dramatically. I definitely think it needs to be broadened and the details gone into, obviously, but that is what I had understood the next stage of work to be. So whereas we can have problems with roundabouts and traffic lights, surely we should be looking at this whole corridor and working out what the best way is to improve the access that is what we're all driving for. So I would be really disappointed if this one was paused at any time, apart from to look properly and widely at the Genome Campus, Sawston, everywhere else, I'm sure, that does come into this, but this sounds like a clear and sensible proposal to me. So I would be in favour of it going forward to the consultation and detailed work.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I'm pleased to hear that the cycling people will be taken into account in their efforts to get a wider cycleway, which I think we all feel is a big part of the future of transport in Cambridge. So the more bikes we bring in, the less cars we bring in. I've just got a couple of questions, a question about if you build a segregated bus lane, what happens to the traffic on the road? So if you put in a bus lane down to the roundabout, do the cars then get the opportunity to go faster and therefore overtake the bus and be in front of it when the bus arrives there? Does that make sense? Does it something that's confused? This is not a challenge, I'm just asking the question. Because if the cars can go faster, they overtake the bus, and they're all in front of the bus, so the bus might just as well be sitting in the traffic jam. Is it possible in these circumstances to think about, if we're talking about from the roundabout into Adamford, talk about some sort of gating system, which is something that's been talked about in the past, not quite so dramatic, but something that will hold the traffic back? Because I very much am in favour of getting people out of their cars and not encouraging them to use the bus, the road, which is now clear of buses. So I don't know if that makes sense.
It does, Chairman. That's always a challenge, and so particularly in an urban environment, reallocate some of the space away from the cars to deal with exactly the problem you talked about. I think, to be honest though, in this instance, that is a much bigger question, because if you start restricting and putting gates and other things, then you affect a whole group of other people. So I think, my simple answer to your question would be, it of course could be considered, but it would need to be considered very, very carefully. But actually the more important thing, and the whole point about bus lanes, is providing as near as possible certainty and reliability of the services. So if you can get that, whether or not a switch of people from car to bus means that the car can go a little bit faster, there is quite significant congestion in those sections already. So even if that becomes a little bit less, if the buses can have absolute reliability and certainty, then it's much more certainty rather than just journey time, if you like, that people require. Then I think our view is that it would make the bus attractive. You could, as I say, look at restrictive measures on the cars, but that I think is a whole different debate that we haven't addressed here and would need to be considered very, very carefully.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor Smith.
Thank you. Okay, I'll start with the positive. It's a very good report, Oh, that we had a report of this quality for the A428. It might not be a saga that it is now. It's gratifying that value for money is a major consideration here. We're looking at a benefit-to-cost ratio between 1.5 and 2, whereas the 4.428 scheme it has a benefit-to-cost ratio of 0.2. Environmental impact seems to be given heavy weight and the need to protect the green belt. The importance of segregation and off-road is being properly considered, and no longer does segregation seem to be of paramount importance, overriding environmental considerations and so on. And the quality of the analysis is just so much superior to the Atkins report for the 8428 that it, you know, doesn't bear looking at, really. WSPBP's report is crammed with detail, including up-to-date traffic data, detailed drawings of all major junctions along the route, segment by segment journey times, and an explanation of the modelling assumptions, and so on. However, there are problems with this, and I agree with the LLF that I think this is premature, and actually the paper itself on page 4 at 19 actually goes some way to explaining why pushing this project through carries risk. And it says the attention should be drawn to two key pieces of work which potentially bring risk and may influence the 1307 scheme going forward, but as yet have not drawn conclusions. And these are running the options through the Cambridge subregional model, the old model, right before the new one is available. So, you know, that may well impact, particularly on the BCR figures. And then also the other work streams going on. So we have, you know, a lot of work which we just awarded considerable extra sums of money to today for all the city access work. And I will be saying the same thing about the 428, you know, which I also think needs to be paused to allow that work to be done and to be properly assessed, because the danger is that we end up doing heavy infrastructure problems, the need for which is then negated by the other things that we are doing. And I've said all along, you know, the Smart Cambridge work, the access work, should be happening first of all, because it is not damaging, it is nothing like as controversial, it doesn't, you know, get people as wound up as they are now. There's other things that need to come forward before it progresses. We need the adopted design guide, which was meant to come to this meeting but has gone back for another look. That's really important, because this route is coming into the city. There are opportunities, which Councillor Orgy has highlighted, for light-touch, small interventions to be implemented, you know, which might change the whole scene. So there are obviously junctions and so on, which could be done at small amounts of cost. And I seem to remember, you know, a number of meetings ago, we approved giving out small sums of money for the sorts of project which can't get funding elsewhere. So we've already got the capability to do that. So, you know, let's get on and do those things that could be done really quickly and then have another look at it so that we're not over-specking these projects. We also know that there are a number of emerging technologies coming forward, you know, which could actually negate this as a strategy altogether. You know, we are probably on the cusp of this sort of strategy being really old-fashioned and old hat. There is stuff coming up behind us, which, you know, could make this all look silly. And, you know, we could have committed money, actually be laying tarmac and concrete, and along comes a new technology, which actually would have been a darn sight cheaper, will be way more effective, and will actually bring Cambridge into the 21st century. So I think we need to stop and let these other things catch up with us a bit, and I don't think we're going to be stopping for very long, but we certainly need to let the city access stuff get done, and that's, you know, that's happening quickly, I think, isn't it, Tanya? So, you know, and it won't take long to assess the impact of that, because otherwise we risk making ourselves look foolish here, quite honestly. So I support the LLF, and I will be saying exactly the same thing about the A428 busway project, because the same thing applies. Let's get this other stuff, this higher tech stuff, done before going back to yesterday's solutions for today's problems.
Councillor
Bid. Yes, Chair, I wasn't going to say anything about this, and then Councillor Bajan, his contribution prompted me. I mean, of course, to the degree we take buses off the road, and whether it's give them a lane by the side or a segregated route somewhere else, We are opening up the possibility of just the roads backfilling with more traffic, and that will be the case whatever we do to speed the buses up. And the congestion will occur because there's road space being freed up, unless we have a proper demand management measure in place of the kind that we've just ruled out at our previous meetings. And so it does remain an open question, the point he makes. It may enable the buses to go a bit faster, but it also enables cars to go a bit faster, and it isn't necessarily going to cause the people to change modes as a result. But that was not what I was intending to say originally. The concerns that have been raised around the LLF, I hear them, but my question is, aren't many of these precisely the sort of concerns that the next phase in the process is designed to address, and that we're in a sense getting a snapshot up front now of what that discussion and process of evaluation is going to be? And my understanding of what would happen after the board makes its decisions next week is that there is in effect a shared planning process with the LLF where some of these concerns would actually be addressed. So the things that are of importance now are the things which go off the table and don't come back on it after today. And I have a question about one of those. But in the context of the LLF, I wonder if officers could help by explaining what questions will be directed to the LLF should the board approve the recommendations that we've got today. What is it that the LLF is going to be asked to help with at the next stage? Because I think it might help settle people that the time for debating some of these things doesn't necessarily stop today or next week, and actually opens out and can be very, very important and valuable. The one question that I have, which relates to a point which potentially would go off the table after the board makes its decision on these recommendations, is about the principle of the park and ride, of having a second park and ride quite a lot further out from the city, as would be proposed near the A11. My question is about the effect of that on the broader system, because you know we've talked a little bit about looking at this as a system, a transport system, and I think that we are looking at a corridor, it's been said, and the corridor is defined, and I'm personally fine with that. But of course, it's next to another corridor and other corridors around the spectrum around the city. So the question is, what do officers think would be the impact of having a park and ride operation running from this area near the A11? What would be the effect of that on scheduled bus services from Sawston into the city?
Officers? Chairman, do you want us to pick up the full range?
No, just that one for the moment.
I'll start on that. I would not see it as reducing the number of buses from Sawston, and I would hope that future work on the corridor would actually give us opportunities to increase it. It might even give us the option to run different services because there'll be more people using combined parking lots.
So the reason for the question is that clearly it opens up the possibility of people going from Sawston to the park and ride rather than taking scheduled bus services from Sawston into the city. And that there is the potential for the scheduled service from Sawston to be cannibalised as a result.
I think the answer is yes.
It is documented, there are numbers of research studies that park and ride does have to a certain extent that effect. There's no doubt about that. I think picking up Jeremy's point though, what we would hope, but it is a good question, what we'd hope is that you would actually grow the overall market. So actually that park and ride is obviously to keep people up on that corridor. But you are right, Councillor Peake, that there is a risk that that happens, and that is a risk with any park and ride sites. It's documented as, you know, being a partial risk, but you can mitigate that by trying to ensure that bus services for the local areas are attractive, and reliable, so you don't actually have to drive somewhere else. But you can't guarantee that it won't happen.
So could I just comment? So for someone who might be concerned about the future of the scheduled bus services from Thorstone, how would you cool their nerves when asked to support this recommendation?
I mean, I think the one example that perhaps we would give would be the bus wing. Well, actually, yeah, we've got more services from St Ives, but actually we have not seen a reduction in services from the villages as a result of the busway itself. There are other factors working in the bus market, but the one area where we have done park and ride that far out and provided the priority, we haven't markedly changed the rural bus market as a result. The rural bus market does, of course, need a fair bit of support and the help it can get, but that was an example where we didn't. But as Graham says, we can't guarantee that will be the case every time. But
so there's been no change in the services from St Ives into Cambridge?
Well, the services from St Ives into Cambridge have gone significantly up.
Because of?
Because of the introduction of the high-quality public transport.
That's the point that Councillor Bick's trying to get across.
Absolutely.
Is the fact that if you have a park and ride there, people will travel from Thorstone to the park and ride, actually more traffic on the roads, to get the high quality public transport system, rather than use the slower, by definition, public transport buses that are in Thorstone at the moment.
If we use the same example though, the park and ride and busway was associated with a 2% reduction in traffic on the A14. Now, obviously, in the context of overall traffic in the A14, you might not notice it, but that actually buys you 2 or 3 years' capacity. It may not seem the biggest thing, but actually it was an observed effect.
Chair, if I could just come back, it's not only the point you made about more people getting in their cars because of the park, right? It's also about people who can only get to a bus not having a car. I mean, that's the isolation point. But, I mean, based on the answers, I'm not saying it's a killer issue the way you're describing it, but is there a way that that can be sort of part? Because it sounds that there are things that could be done to mitigate it, but today's vote, or the vote of the board next week, is saying there is going to be a park right there, and so the idea of no park right there goes off the table. It would be nice if there was just a string onto this issue about the impact on the system, which allowed us to review and see whether other interventions are necessary there.
I think, Chairman, if I may, of course, if the Assembly wants to recommend to the board that that is part of the process, then of course that can be done. And in fact, if the board decided that it didn't want park and ride because of that risk to be part of the strategy, that's also a possibility. So we could definitely look at that. If that is, if you like, the outcome of this overall process. I think all I would say, though, to reinforce what Jeremy has said, in terms of guarantees, we can look at it, we can give estimates, but I think, what we're actually talking about here is growing the overall bus market, and when you put park and ride sites in, they do have a range of impacts. Some of them are positive, and some of them are not always positive. Short of, for example, funding and continuing to fund the other local services, I think it's hard to guarantee that there won't be those impacts. So I think what I'd say, Jeff, is if the Assembly were particularly concerned about it, then it may be something you wish to recommend the board looks at.
Thank you. But I think that's a wider point. I'm trying to bring this all together because Councillor Bick started off, it would be useful if the Assembly knew if the board approved what is going on here, what they would then be asked at the next stage in consultation, etc. And actually, because the park and ride sites aren't up here on a slide, like the LLF saw, and the LLF can comment on it, just the same as the concept that officers have that you should have the busway just westbound, and that's all, and just the same as officers feel that you should narrow Linton High Street. This is what's in the officers' heads at the moment, and that's what will be directed when it goes out to consultation. I think that's what Councillor Bick was trying to get at is the fact that there is these ideas in officers' heads at the moment of where this will lead, and so it would be useful to know what the questions are that the LNF will then be asked at the next stage. Because approving this today, the LNF saw a lot of slides that they didn't agree with and concepts that they didn't agree with, and those slides haven't been presented today. And if they were presented today, then maybe Assembly members would have more of an idea of not only what the LNF saw, but the idea that the officers have in their heads of where this is going.
Well, Chairman, as I say, the Assembly have access to the full consultant report on which the LNF presentations and details of a much, much longer discussion and presentation that I gave today were based. What is actually being discussed is what the consultants have recommended at this stage. And so, as Councillor Dick said, absolutely correctly, this is a process. And so there are a series of general recommendations which, if agreed by the board, will then move on to the next stage, which is refinement. And so, I think Councillor Dick asked the question about what the LLF be asked to do, and the way that in the past, on a range of schemes, not just city deal schemes, we've used the LFS is effectively as a consultative ongoing forum to have a discussion as schemes go through development. So, Jeremy may wish to say more about the terms of reference of the LFS, but we would expect to use the LFS on an ongoing basis. This isn't, if you like, a one-off appearance where we say, thank you very much, now we're going to take it forward. So the point is that if the board agree this broad package, which includes a range of measures, then between now and the point at which consulting the final slide, I didn't actually talk to you because I was out of time, indicated a timescale for consultation. But as I'm sure the board would reflect on, as they have with other schemes, if it takes longer, it may take a bit longer to get the scheme right until it goes out to consultation. So we are narrowing
that's quite interesting. Thank you. Because what you're saying is that actually, in my head, I'm getting a series of workshops here before it goes out to consultation again. Is that what you're saying?
And Chairman, I mean, yeah, as a parallel, for example, another city deal scheme, Milton Road, Houston Road, LNFs, have been extensively resourced. They've had lots of activity sessions. And so, essentially the LNFs work in a way that the chair of the LNF wants to work. I mean, the board, I can't speak for the board, but I think what I can say is that the board certainly has welcomed the input. So yes, I believe that there would be an ongoing consultative process because there is a period of time of, if you like, the development of options which are a bit more detailed than last time they were consulted on, a development that needs to take place from now to when it goes out.
All right, thank you. Dr. Wells.
Thank you, Chair. Clearly there are issues to be resolved, but I mean, I think I'd like to start, I've got a number of points, but I'd like to start by saying, this is an important major route serving the biomedical campus. It is highly congested and it is a dangerous route. So I think maintaining momentum whilst addressing people's concern would be something I think I would very much encourage. This is a very important route and it is, as I say, extremely congested, especially close to Cambridge, and it's key for the biomedical campus. The specific points I wanted to raise is about, a lot of them are about integration. And so Mr. Hughes ended with a point about integration, so I'm glad he made the point. I'll take it in the spirit that more integration is to come, because at the moment my concern is that I don't see it in the papers and in the proposals. So for example, I do have a concern that this is, and I made this comment I think previously, a year ago, this has become a Haverhill to biomedical campus project. But Haverhill to the city centre is also a key route. And what I would not like to see is buses travelling at the speed of light until they get to the Randbrooks roundabout, spend 20 minutes to get round the Randbrooks roundabout and over the Long Grove crossroads before they get to the Hills Road, which then, of course, will be completely traffic-free and flows into the centre. It's got to join up. This is also a route to the city centre, and I fear that the approach of segmenting it to the Randbrooks roundabout could cause a problem at a later date. That would be my first point. The second point is, I think we need to work very hard to integrate this with the thinking of the biomedical campus about where are the best locations for, if you like, bus drop-offs, bus turning circles, bus access to the campus. We are plagued at the moment by buses which spend, you know, 15 minutes wheedling their way entirely through the campus, and that's not ideal in terms of the economics of the bus service. So, you can't declare victory when a bus gets, if you like, to the Adamsworth roundabout. We've got to think about how that integrates with what goes on, if you like, within the boundaries of the campus in order to provide an effective service. Others have mentioned, others have mentioned, you know, what about thinking about Ward's Causeway as an alternative bus route, possibly as a transition issue, because that might be able to be done quite quickly if the preferred long-term solution was off-road. It is already used, as others have commented, it is already used by the bus drivers, and maybe it could be enhanced. Think also about further out, where, what are the collecting mechanisms to get people onto these buses? So if you, you know, if you've got a bus service running from Haverhill, what increases the capture of that location to get more people to get the bus from Haverhill rather than drive partway into Cambridge? So should we be thinking about, you know, collecting mechanisms, park and rides even further out, as an and, not an or, as an and, to try and enhance the flow that goes through that corridor? Because otherwise, if you live just outside Haverhill, you get in your car, and then you've kind of committed at least a half the journey by road. In the section, the congested section from the park and ride up to the Edinburgh roundabout, clearly, if it's an on-road bus solution, as others have said, the width there looks quite challenging. What I think we couldn't afford to do is lose pedestrian space, because a huge number of people walk from Bayburn Park and Ride into the Edinburgh campus and cycle. And so that route needs to be preserved and not squeezed out by the busway. I'm not saying it would have to be, but we need to take care of that. Another point, perhaps to state the obvious, but I didn't see it mentioned anywhere in the papers, is we need to think about emergency vehicles. particularly highlighted by, if we're going to think about, if you like, slowing down the cars, that could also be slowing down the ambulances. So this route is a primary emergency vehicle route. So that must be part of the consideration. And my final point is a slightly broader point, which is just, people recognise I've made a similar plea before, just about the way in which the information is presented in a quantitative form. So, I am originally an engineer. When you do an engineering project, at least it was always drummed into me, the first thing you do, you say, the requirements I need to deliver are the following. So, I would have thought this route needs to transport N people a day from Haverhill to Cambridge, and Y people a day from here. Based on the model, it won't be quite right, but that's a design assumption. And from that, you can then design solutions, and then test, and ultimately, arguably, monitor whether you're delivering what you set out to do. The papers, nowhere in the executive summary, does it mention what this road is being designed to deliver. And I think it should. I think we should set out a clear design requirement and then look at the options and test against that. So, by my calculations, the bus element of this proposal will get 1,600 people a day to work. There are 16,000 people on the biomedical campus. Now, not all of them will come by this route, but it's only 1,600 people. Is that enough? Now, it feels to me too low, but if there are numbers there that say it's fine, well, fine. But there is no statement about what we need to deliver. It only delivers 1,600 by my numbers. So I would make a general plea, because I think this is common again across most of the projects you see, a general plea to say, could we up front, if you like, in the papers, have a quantitative definition about what we're trying to deliver in terms of number of people from location X to location Y, and then test it against those. Because I fear we could spend a lot of time, deliver a project, and find that it doesn't deliver us more than a five-year stopgap rather than the 2031 solution.
Dr. Wells, I always look to you for the figures and the numbers, so thank you for that.
Well, you know I've got a very good record.
Yes, but your points are well made, and don't you? Thank you. Vice Chair.
Thank you, Chair. I'm coming at this, and I agree from the outset with some of the first people that Claire Ruskin said, that, you know, this was a reasonable scheme. And I say that, and I understand where the LLF are coming. I get that. As someone that was part of the Milton Road LLF, which Mr. Hughes mentioned earlier, and I remember the first meetings that we had around that with residents and residents' associations, and the absolute first one was a huge room, absolutely packed to the rafters. And it was pretty unpleasant, and it was pretty hostile. The last LLF meeting was built on a really, really, really good consensus of councillors, and we had one or two councillors working very closely with the residents' associations in that area, and they came up between them all and between those in the LLF with some, you know. Good that it wasn't everything that the board wants, it wasn't everything that the LLF wanted. It's what we, you know, in the end have to do is some form of compromise. Now this sounds to me like the first LLF on proposals coming forward. Hostility and understandable. I get that. I now think it's beholden on those elected representatives, those councillors that are involved in that in the area, to work with officers and to work with other sort of residents and residents. You know, I mean, I'm not sure how your LLF is made up, but it's with residents' associations. So I think that's pretty much something worth bearing in mind, and something probably sparked me into speaking on this one. Something that Councillor Smith said about we should stop until something else, or the next technology comes along. Well, if we do that, we'll never ever do anything, because, you know, as soon as you start something, sure as hell you know there's something else coming along. We can't keep stopping and stopping and stopping and waiting for the next thing to come along. You know, we do have to move forward with these schemes. It says in the reasons for recommendations that public consultation on the preferred options will run in parallel to continuing technical work. So we're not saying to the board here, you know, if we approve this is not saying to the board, there you go, get on with that and build whatever's in there, because that's not what this is about. This is, as I understand it, or this is a pretty much a starting point, and there are changes that can and will be made to it, but it needs people to get involved and to genuinely discuss. So their reasons for opposing things in this are out there in the open, and ways round it, well, ways to get moving will be found, because, you know, like I said, it was done very, very well on the Milton Road scheme. It was hard, it was tough, it was a lot of hard work. Not by me, there were other people doing a lot of hard work there. And I think with the right determination and will, that you can do the same there.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Cavanagh?
Yeah, I'd just like to add to that, plea to keep the momentum going on this. I think this report here is very good. I actually took the time to go through the bigger aspects of this report on the website. very technical for me, lots of figures, if you like figures and so on, but it actually added a depth that was behind here. But one of the things I've noticed here is we've got 1,489 logged responses. I mean, that's a fair number of responses there, and I think we've got a responsibility to these people who have actually gone to the trouble to actually respond to, in the consultation process. And what was interesting in that, if you just look down, it's on page 3, it says 53% of respondents, car users, then you've got cyclists, 33%, and walkers, 28%. And interestingly enough, it was on the website where I got the figure for the people who use public transport was 20%. Should be here as well. But what we're aiming for really is that is at the higher level is to shift these figures, isn't it? To get the 20% of people on buses that responded here, turn them into the 53%. You know, that's what's part of the whole city deal thing. And it's also very encouraging that even in the discussions earlier on, the points made by Cam Cycles, there's already a response from Graham, who was saying, yes, we're going to look more carefully at the needs of the cyclists going alongside the road and so on. So that's how it happens, that's how the process happens. I mean, what worries me, it's going back to the momentum and it's slowing up, is that, I mean, it is good that the LLF had, 30 people turn up? But when you put 30 people and do a straw poll, that's just not enough to stop this project in its tracks. It's just too important. I'm thinking of the 1,500 people. And also the other thing I'm thinking of is Dr. Wells just mentioned the danger. I mean, it is a dangerous route. I mean, I've driven along there, I've cycled along. Into Cambridge, out of Cambridge, all of that. And a couple of weeks ago, I was joined, very pleased to see Councillor Hicks there and Councillor Cuffley there at the opening of the Wigglesworth 2.
Someone main. Stole my light for that day.
But I could
see. Thankfully. Yeah, thanks for that.
I can see Councillor Hicks, very, very impressed by the number of people who've come out on their bikes, families, for the opening of this cycleway, which in some ways is kind of like a precursor to the greenways, which I hope will be built across not just South Cambridgeshire, but actually go up to the north part of the county and so on. But finally, I'm on my way back to Cambridge and along the cycleway that goes up, you know, by Wandlebury, and we've got this new farm shop there. There I just witnessed the near miss, awful. And so it could have happened because of the speed, you know, cars went over the hill and then you've got to come out there. And so something has to be done. So if we're going to stall it, there's like more casualty. I'm not going to sound histrionic or anything, but there might be more casualties in the interim. So I think let's just get on with it. There'll be plenty of time for the LLFs to have their input and so on. And finally, I'm going to say one of the big positive things about this is the suggestion of the second park and ride. And I think it was mentioned there that the debate is open about where the park and ride is going to go, the second one. So let's just talk about where it's going to go, not killing it off, the whole idea. So keep it moving.
Okay, thank you. Tim,
oh, thank you, Chairman. Yes, well, I've been here for over 3 hours. I thought I should say something. I myself cycled from Cottenham to Grant Park at 6 o'clock in the morning on the 18th of January to attend the Cambridge Ahead event this year. And it was a glorious ride, and I have to say that I did become fully aware of how treacherous it is in places, and that something definitely needs to be done in this corridor. But more seriously, as you know, I'm the executive member for strategic planning at South Cambridge District Council, and picking up the point that Mr. Chisholm made about the Genome Campus at Hinkston Horn and the relationship between the A1307, the A1301 and the A505. And thinking ahead to the work that the London Stansted Cambridge corridor is doing and noises that we've heard from Uttlesford about potential major development just the other side of the border. And I've got a drawing here which shows these blue bulbs. Blue bulbs are the major employment centres in Greater Cambridge. And as you see, there's a sort of preponderance towards the southeast. And my information is that there's going to be a doubling of employment at those three research campuses, never mind what's happening at Cambridge Biomedical Campus. So yes, definitely something has to be done. I can see that there is a case for maintaining momentum, but also I do pick up the concerns that have come out of the local liaison forum. So I don't know exactly how you're going to play this, Chairman, but clearly we have to keep the process going, but maybe we should look a little bit more at some of the refinements. And then for my personal plea is, can we have some element of future-proofing about what we're doing? Because I'd be really disappointed if we spent a lot of money sort of patching up to tackle an existing problem when we could take the opportunity, seize the opportunity of doing something that could put us in very, very good stead for the next 20, 50 years along this particular corridor.
Thank you. Now, certainly, I haven't spent the last 7 years of my life working on something on this just to ditch it, but I think it's important that we get it right. That's where I am. Helen Valentine.
I too would like to keep up the momentum because if we pull on this project, there isn't going to be any pause in the kind of growth of the biomedical campus or the other kind of research parts. And it seems to me that there will be ample scope in the further consultation for all of the concerns to be taken into account. And I also, I think somebody has said, and I would echo, that the wider consultation that it started with large numbers of respondents who are in general very positive about this development. And although it's important, obviously, that the people in the LLF have some concerns, there are much smaller population. So I think we should keep going and we should keep consulting, and I'm sure that in the end the scheme will be better than it is at the moment.
Okay, thank you. I've got some people that want to speak again. I was going to come in, but I'm not going to, so I'm going to let these people speak again and maybe I'll come at the end. Councillor Smith.
Okay, I'm going to try and be positive here, and I also want to pick up on something John said about the paper not identifying the requirements that are needed to deliver. So I was at a Highways England presentation all morning about the nuclear project as part of the Oxford-Cambridge Expressway, the first phase of it, which is going to be the Caxton Gibbet to Black Cat roundabout. And they started off by talking about what their objectives were in all their projects. And it was a bit of a masterclass, actually, in delivering big infrastructure projects. It was really interesting. So they aimed, their objectives were an improved environment, a safe and serviceable route, free-flowing traffic, increased economic growth, a project that integrates into other schemes, and their new objective is customer satisfaction. And that's not just customer satisfaction with the end product, it's customer satisfaction with the whole process all the way through. So we are at risk of blowing customer satisfaction here from the outset. So I think we need to address it, because we have blown it on the A428 project, and we don't want to do it again, and I don't want to do it again. So if I may suggest that a short pause, for want of a better word, could be used to run some high-quality workshops with our customers. And on the point of the LLF, it has very restricted membership. So actually not 1,500 people can't go to it because they're not eligible to it. It's only councillors in the catchment area who are eligible to vote at LLFs. So if we could run some high-quality workshops quickly, in a short pause, just to engage with our customers and try and take our customers with us through this process, because this could be time very well spent. So we, you know, by delaying for a short period now, we could actually avoid the whole project being caught up in the courts with judicial reviews for years and years, which is what is a potential risk elsewhere within the city deal world. So, you know, that I hope that's a positive suggestion about how we can move this forward, and we can, I mean, I hear what everyone's saying about keeping up momentum, but, you know, we could keep up momentum and then hit a brick wall if we get this wrong, and we forget that the people out there are our customers, and we don't take this opportunity now at this early stage to take them with us.
Okay,
thank you
for that. Claire Maskey. Well, just to follow, I do agree with Bridget that... but I always view workshops as work, not as a pause. So I would just differ on workshops is part of the next stage of work. Mm-hmm. On the numbers, then there are clear plans for all of the parks, including Chesterford and everywhere else. They're all saying they're doubling in size, so I think that could just be an average that we take of everywhere's going to double in size. They either say 10% or doubling, so take doubling. And the other point was, again, Bridget, you commented that we should wait to the next technology. I think this would add beautifully to the next technology. So if we looked at some of the very exciting possibilities that we have, this doesn't conflict with it, it actually adds to it. You still need the safety, you still need to have this corridor improved.
Okay.
The others can add.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Cuffley?
Like everybody else, I've heard a lot of what's been said, and I've taken on board a lot of what's been said, and I agree with Councillor Slip and also agree with Councillor Price. It is down to the members to win this, put this over. And sometimes you're not pausing, you're just stepping back, you're looking, and then you can actually move forward a lot faster. The bottom line of this is the majority of people that actually turned up at this LLF were not against the upgrade of the 1307. What they was against is A, a badly pulled, B, a lately pulled, and that was their concern.
Just a correction there, the poll I think is generally considered quite good, it's the presentation
that the presentation, right, I do want to clarify that. The presentation was not a particularly good presentation. And the fact that it obviously, you know, with the greatest amount of respect, you had plenty of time to get that report together to put that forward. You know, you come up with a million excuses about not delivering it, but at the end of the day, you had time.
I've let everyone else. I'm just saying, I don't think we should be attacking officers, actually. We've covered it.
You're asking for a positive, I'm trying to...
Can we just move
positive
on?
Positive. As I said at the beginning, is generally speaking, they were not against the whole idea. But there are times when you need to sit back and look at what you've got, and what we were fed was not particularly healthy. Now, if that can be addressed, if we can move forward with that, and we're all for that, we're not gonna set out to make any issues here. Let's take on board that was said, how the LLF reacted and everything else. And let's draw the positives out of this. There are some positives in there, but I do think there's still a very long way to go, and probably workshops is the best way.
Okay, fine. I appreciate your comments. So what, okay. Councillor Algy, I was actually going to have my say, but don't, please, off you go.
Very quick. First of all, the members of local liaison forum are county councillors, district councillors and parish council representatives from all the villages of Longroot and into Cambridge. We have two representatives from residents' associations in Cambridge as well. Secondly, the presentation of officers at the LLF. First of all, beforehand, I'd ask them to keep it fairly brief because I wanted to allow the maximum time for discussion. But I said that expecting the report to be published beforehand. When people came along to the LLF, they were cold. So in a sense, the presentation was effectively all new information for everybody there. So that's what made it difficult. As the presentation was clear enough, it was just that people had no background at all when they came to it. And the final point I've made, this was something that was said, and it picks up from what Mr. Wells said. Fine if you can get people to the Adam Brooks campus, but I've been in a bus for 45 minutes or an hour on a Friday afternoon from the Catholic Church to Adam Brooks. And if people can get to Adam Brooks, decide that bungalow campus, fine. But if they want to progress, they're going to be held up in all that traffic going into and coming out. And unless that's sorted out, you never get the buses running to time, because they're just held up for so long in that intermediate period. And so I do fully support your point about this really ought to be between Haverhill and the city centre, as opposed to just considering as far as the biomedical campus.
Okay, thank you. Well, I will have my say. I actually got prepared quite a lot of challenges, etc. But some have been mentioned, some haven't been mentioned. But actually, I'm trying to pull this together and find the way forward. And if you look in your report, the recommendations on four. A, it says note the draft consultation report for publication on the Greater Cambridge Citadel website. I think that's fine, and the general consensus is it's quite a good report. So, can I get some nods around that? Excellent. Okay, good. But then it goes on, B, and it says review the preferred options, etc., approve further technical work, and then it's got Roman numerals 1 to 7. And that's all the preferred options, but obviously there's been some challenges about. Not only, I think it's important that we keep the momentum going, that's been said by absolutely everyone, but there's been some major concerns, and Dr. Wells, Councillor Smith, Councillor Cuffley, Councillor Woodspoon, Councillor Bick, even Mr. Hughes actually, with the busway only going one way, and it needs further work to be looked into. So I think, although there's challenges with the Roman numerals on B, and then when you go to C, it says endorse a second public consultation exercise on the preferred options to commence June 2017 and agree a delegation to finance a consultation. That, to me, is too soon. We don't want to stop the momentum, but we want to get it right, like I said before. And therefore, before anything goes out to consultation, we need the workshops that have been actually suggested by officers. So if we have the workshop suggested by officers, I would imagine we're March now. We must be talking at least two or three. And so nothing could possibly come back here much before July or August for it to go out to consultation August, September. That to me would make much more sense than, because if we keep to the June 17, I don't see how the input that we've all talked about that's so vital can happen. But at least if we just say we're going to get it right, and we still have the time frame as best we can. The momentum keeps going, but also the input from everyone else. Am I along the right tracks here?
Yeah. If this were important, we would be doing this by June. If this were important to us, it's doable. We're in March now.
Well, I personally don't see how we can get that done if there's two or three workshops. And then officers have to go away, work up, and come back to the next workshop. That's just me personally. But I've got nods from other people that, just to delay this maybe for two or three months, for the consultation process, makes sense. Okay.
What did the officers think about this elongated...
Well, that was my next question, so thank you, pseudo-chair.
I know. On that tandem again.
I know. So, Chair, officers.
Yeah, Chairman, can I just cover, just to make sure that this only understands what the recommendation is, and I think you're suggesting to change that. So just to be clear, the recommendation was not to bring it back, hence the use of the word delegation. So the proposal was, if the board agrees this set of options, to then do the further technical work on those options, and then following that technical work, to actually go out to the consultation in June of this year. So just to be clear, that's what the recommendation as drafted says. So there would be a period of technical work between when the board meets, which I think is the 8th of March, and then when it goes out to consultation. So, Chairman, on the point that you've raised, I think the reality is, depending on the number of workshops in the process, the reality is if there was a significant process of workshops, so several workshops that have to be prepared for and probably run in sequence, and then, as you say, the information to be collated, then I think my view is it would push the consultation beyond June 2017. We have assumed that there would be technical work and there would be engagement in that period, but obviously the more process is put in, then the less likely it is we are to hit that date. And then just the other thing I would say, not to say it's right or wrong, but just to be clear that obviously if we don't hit June, then in reality you're almost certainly moving it. Which you may see as a good idea, yeah, as an assembly, that you push it to September.
No, I'm trying to get the
consultation during the summer holidays. But in reality, I think if there were a significant amount of extra work, probably naturally moving towards that sort of time scale.
Okay, well, thank you for that. But, you know, in the grand scheme of things, we're talking 3 months, which overall isn't that significant.
In terms of the overall programme, Chairman, I mean, it's a relatively small period of time. Clearly, it's for the assembly and the board to decide how they would interpret to run that process.
Right, so from officers, if we were to look at going forward with the A1307 regard workshops regarding councillors, the LLF, etc., and probably looking at 2 or 3 workshops with the working between from officers, we will be pushing the consultation back from June to September because of the holiday period. We probably could have done August, but we're not going to do August, so it probably would be September. So I'm trying to gather all the information from everyone, and so if we can still keep the proposals, if you like, or even though the LLF rejected them, we can still keep the proposals on the proviso that actually these workshops are going to happen and the proper input is done. And I think the LLF would like that more than anything else, because there's no one at the LLF that just said scrap the whole thing. It was more let's go and do this properly, so that would make more sense to me. So I'm going to propose that from the chair, because I'm trying to find a way forward here. And D, approve the one-off spend of £25k to undertake some transport modelling. The general consensus at the LLF for what that's worth is why hell hasn't that been done already? So there was support from that. So, Councillor Bajan, is this a technical point?
Or yes,
is this
a technical
point. Okay, yeah. Off you go.
Am I hearing that this will be the last time, when the board consider it, that there will be a political touch to this before the final proposal is drawn up for final consideration?
I think yes, because we haven't got time. I don't want to delay it, as people are worried about, but if there's the proper workshops and input going into it, when it goes out to consultation, hopefully that will be in a form and package that will gain a lot more support going forward, and then it will come back to the board after the consultation, so it will come back to us as well. That's where I am with it, yeah.
Sure. Can I just see Anthony here as well for a while? And not highways, actually. Something we might just want to cover off. I'm not sure whether it will or it won't, but we move into a perda period. And whether workshops in a perda period, I don't know. It might just be something to worth looking at. I'm not saying that we would need to move those on.
No, it's a workshop.
Think,
yeah,
it's not
decision
making.
It's
not about publicising a councillor that's standing for election, which is more
permanent. No, I know. Yeah.
And it's not decision making, yeah. So I appreciate it, but I think it's
okay.
Fine.
Okay.
So I'm trying to move on, so I'd like to propose that from the chair. So, you know, I don't need to second it or anything. I'd just like to know if there's support for that around the room. So, all those in favour, please raise your hands on that particular one.
Can you just exactly what's on the paper,
yeah,
but just to happen culminating in September rather than in June?
Yes, because we're trying to accommodate workshops to make sure that the proposals that go out to consultation actually have a lot more support than maybe what they have at the moment. So, yes, that's what I'm proposing. So, all those in favour? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Anyone totally against? 2, 3. Okay, so 8, 3 in favour. How many of us are there at the moment? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. There you go, 8, 3. All right, so that's kind of way forward. There's obviously been a lot of discussion. I should put that, obviously, to the board. All our concerns. So thank you everyone for bearing with us on that one. It's a difficult one. I think it can wait for us. Thank you. Yeah, that's it. We can all go. I'm only joking. Of course I'm not going to let you out. I just need to find my agenda. Okay, agenda item 9, industrial strategy. All those that wish to leave, please do so. Apart from assembly members, yes. I didn't realise I had to say that again. Okay. Agenda item 9, industrial strategy. The purpose of this is to shape the key themes that Greater Cambridge Partners wish to emphasise in response to the government's industrial strategy. Rachel, you're going to give an introduction to this one, because who isn't here?
So, Andrew Lim, from the City Council, wrote the report, and he sends his apologies that he can't be here today, but he has emailed you all, and even thrown himself in your comment. And so I will try to keep this brief in light of the time. And actually, you know, there isn't a particular decision we're looking for today. This was really to give the Assembly members the opportunity to input into Greater Cambridge City Guild's response to the consultation. So the industrial strategy came out at the sort of turn of the year, quite a weighty document, and it just feels appropriate that we, along with other partnerships, business groups, the LEM, the universities would be making a response to this, because there's a lot within the industrial strategy that really does link in with what we are endeavouring to do here. So, you know, the ambitions of the industrial strategy have to have a lot of synergy with what we're trying to do. And as Greater Cambridge is, of course, a functional economic area with clearly defined strengths, it's something that we need to be able to feed back a strong message to government about where we see the direction going. And some of the sectors that they're particularly keen to hear from are represented very strongly within that Greater Cambridge area. So the other thing that government is saying to us is that they very much want a cross-sectoral response, and we are a cross-sectoral partnership. They're also saying it's, you know, it's a green paper, so there is they very much are in listening mode, so it's an opportunity to be really sort of clear and consistent across those different sort of stakeholder groups that we go back and make sure that it reflects that sort of, you know, genuine concern and aspirations that we all have about how we're able to facilitate the strengths that we have and make sure that we can facilitate growth and create conditions for growth as we move forward. So the aim is that we have some clear and consistent responses, and Andrew will be working with some of those other networks and other stakeholders to make sure that we achieve that. So obviously the government is inviting responses. They've set out sort of 10 pillars. Our suggestion is that we might not, you know, try to update about 38 questions or something like that allocated to those 10 pillars. We're not suggesting that we will need to go through all of that in our response, but the opportunity for you this afternoon, or to take the opportunity to go back to Andrew separately, is just to comment if there are any particular themes that you think we should highlight in our response when we go back. The nature of the timeline, I'm afraid, is that the deadline is in April, on April the 17th, so the other reason for bringing it here, not as a finalised response, is because you just don't have a meeting cycle to be able to do that. So we are asking for delegation to then sign that off. But in the spirit of you know, giving you the opportunity to comment on what I think is a really important strategy that fits very well with the aspirations of the partnership, we thought we would bring it here and then take it to the board to have a similar opportunity. But I won't say more than that. Hopefully you've read the paper and can see some of the detail behind the pillars.
Okay, thank you. Any questions? Councillor Wilson.
Yes, Chairman, I'm the sort of sad character who has read the entire industrial strategy green paper, all 107 pages or whatever it is. And the first thing I guess I ought to say, my impression is that it isn't a strategy. However, having said that, it is being pushed by Greg Clark, who, as you know, is very keen on city deals. And I certainly get the message that where he talks about areas and sectors, he may even be thinking about formal deals in the same way as we had for city deals. So we fit into both an area, a possibility of an area deal, and more particularly a sector deal, particularly in life sciences. And of course, it's Sir John Edge of the other place who is leading the work on putting together the biosciences offer to government. And I'm just wondering, does anyone around the table know what our engagement with Professor Edge is, or has been, or will be? So that's my first question. Sorry?
John Bell.
I don't know where I got that from. So that's my first question. And then the second point I'd like to make is that I went to a lecture in Liverpool by Vince Cable.
I can't
couple of weeks ago, and some of you may remember him. Yeah. He was the business secretary in a previous administration, and I was rather impressed by what he had to say, in fact. And he said that he was very pleased to see many of the ideas in the industrial strategy, because there's been a considerable continuity in approach from the past few administrations, beginning with Michael Heseltine and continued through Peter Mandelson. Some of us may even remember him.
No.
And indeed Vince Cable himself. So and the thrust of the approach is that that the best way to boost economic growth, particularly local economic growth, is to devolve powers over particularly things like transport and skills and all the other stuff to local areas. And he was very, very, very strongly supportive of the devolution settlements that have been made, particularly to the northern areas, but also to Cambridgeshire and Peterborough. So I was quite surprised to hear that, given the political colour that he represents. But I thought I would throw that in for good measure. So there we are. Yes. Sorry to get the name wrong, but I know who you are.
Claire Buskin, follow that if you can, please. You also
read
the industrial strategy.
So I have to actually comment on it before it was published. So I
then
didn't have time to read it, obviously. But it does mention Cambridge and Cambridge Network, I'm proud to say, in quite specifically, which means that I think we do have an obligation and an invitation to respond to it.
Okay.
The strategy I would suggest is that actually we will look very strong if we can put in multiple submissions, filling in the boxes that we are relevant to, because not any one organisation can fill in every single question in there. So what I'd like to suggest, and I think Rachel and Andrew probably are very much at the pinnacle of this, is if we can have all the organisations that are known around Cambridge to want to submit a response, that we actually cross-reference the other people in our joined-up Cambridge submission, and that we have a multiple offering going in with them all linked up. Now that will take some work, but probably takes less work than us trying to do a joined up written response to all thousands of questions that there are.
I think that's an excellent idea. Have we got the resource for that?
Yeah, that's definitely, I mean, the report sort of indicates that, but Claire said it much more eloquently. Yeah. That's absolutely the intention. I think we will be a much stronger partnership response if we have an alignment of those.
Brilliant.
So
okay.
We can do that, and there's a will amongst those
partnerships
to do it. So
we
can.
So that's an action bit.
I get the area bit, but that's pretty much my question about the sector bit and how closely we're working with the biosciences theme. Because we should obviously.
Should I try and answer that as well a bit?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
You'll be aware that we have all sorts of quasi geopolitical maps, etc. Sectors don't conform to any of those. So One Nucleus, for example, which will be part of the BIA response because they won't make a specific sector response, covers London, Cambridge and international. So many of the sector responses are national, not geographic in terms of our region. We are strong in about 8 sectors at world-class level, and therefore we should mention that. And I have a cute little diagram that I use, but we should be careful not to pretend that we are representing sectors properly, because I don't think we can. But if we have a university response, hospital response, and the different organisations, we will potentially get some additional funding to that we have now, which is of course the aim. So if we're just writing something nice.
Thanks. Okay. So who's taking the lead on this? No.
Sorry, from an officer, but so Andrew Lim will continue to full city deal and work on.
Okay, so you're Tim.
In a way, very closely related to what Jim and Tim was saying. I mean, the thing that's really, it's really interesting about Cambridge in industrial terms is this the cluster that has given rise to the success. And there's a theory that goes with it called agglomeration theory, which makes it a textbook case in many terms. A clustering of similar types of activity among small companies all in a defined location.
and that is really kind of, it creates the sense of a pool of people with similar skills that can move between a location of expertise. And I mean, I think that needs to be a very important theme of the way we go back, because it's place-based. I mean, it is sort of sectoral, but it's place-based. And so sort of the emphasis and the importance of place-basedness for the strategy, I think, is critical. And the conditions, probably on a national basis, that encourage that to come about, but in our case, the conditions that kind of help it to sustain itself and to prosper once it's happened. But that seems to me what Cambridge is special about, has something worth saying also on a national basis as well as for ourselves.
Okay, thank you. And the recommendations here are A and B, and actually B says to delegate authority to you, Rachel.
Yeah, yeah.
I know you tried to upload it to Andrew, but unfortunately, it shouldn't. I know
you
will.
Do the work.
Okay. So A and B as read, and along the lines of obviously what's been discussed. Is everyone in agreement?
Mm.
Yeah, great. Really? Thank you very much. Go to the next meeting, Wednesday, the 7th of June, 2 p.m. in the Council Chamber, Guildhall.